Hello everyone, I am Ekaterina Shashina, an Associate Professor of General Hygiene Department. We continue to study hygiene. Today we study a new factor that can influence on the human body, occupation conditions. Discipline industrial hygiene has been defined by American Industrial Hygiene Association as follows. It's science devoted to the recognition, evaluation, and control of those environmental factors and stresses arising in or from the workplace, which may cause sickness, impaired health and well-being, or significant discomfort and inefficiency among workers. Environmental factors and stresses at the workplace called working conditions. And the first part of our lecture is devoted to the characteristics of them. Working conditions are determined by socioeconomic, technical, and organizational and natural factors. Socioeconomic factors include regulatory legal acts, socio-psychological and economic factors. The regulatory legal acts at the federal level are called, for example, the labor code applies in Russia. Then federal laws, presidential and government decrees, orders, sanitary norms and rules, state standards. All of them describe the requirements for labor protection and enterprises, as well as sectoral and intersectoral agreements. Both state and municipal entities have the right to issue normative legal acts. Socioeconomic factors are characterized by the forms of relationships in collectives, the attractiveness of labor, the level of wages, the duration of the leave, the quality of labor, the attitude to work, staff turnover, and other indicators. Among technical and organizational factors are means of labor, objects of labor, instruments of labor, manufacturing rules, organization of production, and work-life balance. Working conditions are also natural factors that include biological, climatic, and geological characteristics of workplace, for example, hypoboreism, altitude hypoxia, wind power, solar activity, environmental radioactivity, electromagnetic field, climate, and atmospheric precipitates. We differentiate production factors due to the impact on the human body into optimal, permissible, harmful, and hazardous. Action of harmful factor leads to occupational disease or reduction of labor productivity. Hazardous production factor leads to traumatism, acute poisoning, or risk of death. So hazardous factors entail more serious effects to human health and even life. Various production factors that can cause sickness, impaired health, or significant discomfort in workers can be classified by nature as chemical, physical, biological, and psychophysiological. Physical factors include such things as high level of noise, vibration, ultrasound, infrasound, air temperature, dramatic changes in barometric pressure, dust leading atmosphere of workplace, high or low humidity and floor air rate, high level of ionizing radiation, magnetic fields, inadequate illumination, high level of ultraviolet and infrared radiation. The majority of occupational health hazards arise from excessive airborne concentration of chemical agents in the form of vapors, gases, dusts, fumes, and mists. In addition to the hazard of inhalation, some of these materials may act as skin or eye irritants or may be toxic both by absorption through the skin and by oral intake. To recognize occupational factors, a health and safety professionals must first know about the chemicals used as raw materials, the nature of the products and byproducts manufactured. This sometimes requires great effort. The degree of risk of handling a given substance depends on the magnitude and duration of exposure. It, in turn, is dependent on aggregative state of a chemical, exposure route, concentration of chemical substance in the exposure medium, human body contamination rate, and contact surface area. Taking into account all these factors, we can consider that inhalation is the major route of entry for hazard of chemicals in the working environment. Indeed, the contact surface area in cases inhalation exposure route, respiratory surface in the lungs, ranges from about 28 square meters at rest to about 93 square meters at deep inspiration. In the course of an 8-hour day of moderate work, a human breathes 8.5 cubic meters of air, or 20 cubic meters per 24 hours. The first ventilation exposure to large delicate lung surface differs from the exposure of ambient air to the skin, which has some 1.9 square meters of surface and a thickness measured in millimeters. It's evident that the lungs represent by far the most extensive and intimate contact of the body with the ambient atmosphere. Then, inhalation as a route of entry is particularly important because of the rapidity with which a toxic material can be absorbed in the lungs, passed into the bloodstream, and reach the brain. Also, inhalation is a major dangerous route of xenobiotic intake because it is difficult to prevent. It is easier to prevent skin contact during the work. Oral intake of chemicals at the workplace may be only due to violation of safety rules if workers eat or smoke at the workplace. Chemical substances can be divided into some groups. The first group is substances of specific action. For example, allergens. They are agents that cause recurrent effects when the worker becomes sensitized allergic to the substance. The first few exposures may cause no reaction, but once a person becomes sensitized, reactions can occur from later contact with very small quantities for very short periods of time. Another one is carcinogens. In common usage, carcinogens refers to any agent that can produce or accelerate the development of malignant or potentially malignant tumors or malignant neoplastic proliferation of cells. And others, aerosol, particulate pollutants, gonadotropic chemicals, clerogenic mineral dust, and so on. The second group is substances and compounds with the same chemical structure. For example, aldehydes, halogens, organic acids, heavy metals, aromatic hydrocarbons, etc. The third group is complex chemical mixes, compounds and chemical substances with the same application, such as dyes and pigments, pesticides, detergents, drugs, and so forth. Biological factors are any living organism or its properties that can cause an adverse response in humans. Work-related illnesses due to biological agents have been widely reported, but in many workplaces, their presence and resolved illness are not well recognized. It's estimated that the pollution at population, at least for occupational biohazards, may be several hundred million workers worldwide. Approximately 200 biological agents are known to produce infections or allergenic, toxic, or carcinogenic reactions in workers. Most of the identified biohazardous agents belong to the following groups: microorganisms and their toxins, viruses, bacteria, fungi, and their products, resulting in infection or allergy. Arthropods, crustaceans, and arachnids, associated with bites or stings, resulting in skin inflammation. Systemic intoxication and transmission of infectious agents or allergic response. Allergens and toxins from higher plants producing dermatitis, rhinitis, or asthma. The next group is protein allergens, such as urine, feces, hair, saliva, and dander. Other groups with the potential to expose workers to biohazards include lower plants or with an, other than fungi, such as lichen, liverworts, hands, and invertebrate animals other than arthropods, parasites such as protozoa, schistosoma, and roundworms, ascaris. Work is engaged in agricultural, medical, and laboratory work have been identified as most at risk to occupational biohazards. But many varied workplaces present the potential for such exposure. Risk of infection varies with the type and species of animal and geographic location. Disease may be contacted directly from animals, but more often it's acquired in the workplace environment. Physiological factors are labor heaviness at physical work and labor intensity at mental work. The factors of labor heaviness include physical effort, load weight, improper lifting or reaching, repeated motions in an awkward posture, displacement. These factors can result in accidents or illness in the occupational environment. Another one is static work. Very fatiguing situation encountered in industry, which unfortunately is often overlooked, is static or isometric work. Because very little outward movement occurs, it seems that no muscular effort is involved. Often, however, such work generates more muscular fatigue than work involving some outward movements. A cramped working posture, for example, is a substantial source of static muscular loading. Underworking intensity means such factors as mental strain, sense organ strain, emotional stress, monotonous work, and behavior. In real life, it's seldom when a worker is exposed to one production factor. It's more often several factors influence on a worker simultaneously. There are three types of such exposure. It may be a combined effect when several chemicals enter the human body by one route. For example, when a worker is exposed to a mixture of gases. Then complex effect, one chemical enters the human body by different routes. Inhalable, oral, or dermal. And it may be cooperative effect. It is exposure to different factors by nature, for instance, chemical and physical, biological and physical. The second part of our lecture is devoted to the assessment of workers' health status. Health status of working population is characterized by following indicators: temporary working disability, occupational and work-related diseases, and occupational accident and injury or traumatism. Occupational disease covers all pathological conditions induced by prolonged work. For example, by excessive exertion or exposure to harmful factors, inherent and materials, equipment, or the working environment. Occupational diseases are essentially defined by etiological characteristics, that is, a slowly acting occupational case, contrary to accidents, where the cause acts rapidly. Occupational diseases are not defined by nosological characteristics because the latter in most cases are not specific. There are diseases which practically affect workers only, and there are conditions having a low incidence in general population. These diseases can very clearly be related to an occupation. So these diseases are primarily a result of an exposure to risk factors arising from work activity. It's possible to identify a specific cause for certain diseases. For example, silicosis caused by silicon dioxide exposure. Vibration disease is a result of vibration action, radiation sickness due to exposure to ionizing radiation, hearing impairment is a result of noise impact, and occupational intoxication caused by industrial poisons exposure. Whereas other diseases are due to several factors exposure, and working conditions may play a role together with others, non-production factors, in the development of such diseases. There are so-called work-related diseases. It means some systemic diseases for which causal relationship of certain occupational factors is identified. For example, occupational asthma among chemical plant workers and farmers, tuberculosis among medical workers who have contact with tuberculosis patients or contaminated objects, osteoarticular diseases among coal industry workers. And the third variant of diseases that can occur among workers is the most difficult for diagnosis. There are common diseases that are aggravated by work factors or having a high incidence owing to conditions of work. These diseases are caused by etiological factors inherent in the circumstances in which the work is done, such as bad posture or repeated physical effort or physiological stress, and which would therefore deserve to be recognized as occupational diseases, but this recognition ought not to be extended to all work of this type. And vice versa, these diseases often occur in people that do not work in such working conditions. For example, gastric ulcer, varicose veins, radiculitis among workers of heavy industry, neurosis, cardiovascular system disorder among workers whose work is accompanied by significant neuropsychiatric component. So, to make a conclusion, what type of disease we have in certain cases occupational, work-related, or common, we should do a hygienic diagnostic to establish relationship between production factors and disease. For occupational disease, this relationship is the strongest, for common disease is the weakest. If cause-effect relationship with the occupational activity is not established, a disease is not considered occupational. Occupational accident is defined as an external, sudden, unexpected violent event during the execution of work or arising out of it, which causes damage to the health or loss of the life of the employee. In the worst case scenario, it represents a fatal occupational accident. Occupational accident may cause occupational injuries. Occupational injury is bodily damage resulting from work. In 1973, World Health Organization defined prior directions in occupational medicine, early detection of health violation. It means the detection of homeostatic and compensatory disorders when biochemical, morphological, and functional changes are reversible. One of the early detection methods is the identification of biochemical markers and structural morphological changes. For example, lead exposure marker is lead concentration in urine and blood. Marker of organophosphorus pesticides is choline esterase activity in blood. Benzene exposure marker is chromosomal aberrations. Another method is functional changes identification with electrocardiography, ultrasonic diagnostics, functional tests such as spirometry, tests of vascular strength, exercise test, audiometry, determination of the central nervous system condition. In many countries, more than half of workers are employed in the informal sector with no social protection for seeking health care and lack of regulatory enforcement of occupational health and safety standards. Only one third of the countries have programs dealing with these issues. Currently, specialized occupational health services are available only for 15% of workers across the world, primarily in big companies that offer health insurance and employment injury benefits. With the ongoing global job crisis, more and more people seek labor in the informal sector without any insurance cover and no occupational health services. Many such workers often also work in hazardous conditions and suffer work-related diseases, injuries, and disabilities. In many communities, when the breadwinner falls sick, the entire family suffers, as there is no social protection. Annually, more than 12 million people, mostly in developing countries, die from non-communicable diseases while still of active working age. Work-related health problems result in an economic loss of 4 to 6% of gross domestic products for most countries. The basic health services to prevent occupational work-related diseases cost on average between $18 to $60 per worker. Researchers have demonstrated that workplace health initiatives can help reduce sick leave absenteeism by 27% and healthcare costs for companies by 26%. In the majority of countries, physicians and nurses are not adequately trained to address work-related health problems, and many countries do not offer postgraduate education in occupational health. Certain occupational risks, such as injuries, noise, carcinogenic agents, airborne particles, and ergonomic risks, account for a substantial part of the burden of chronic diseases. So, more than a third of all cases of back pain is related with working conditions. About 15% of hearing loss and chronic obstructive pulmonary disease, about 10% of asthma injuries, lung cancer and depression, and 2% of leukemia. There is the following contribution on different causes of chronic occupational diseases. Imperfection of technological processes, about 50% of cases. Disadvantages of instrument of labor, about 40%. Imperfection of workplace organization, imperfection of plant design and professional contact with causative agents, about 3, 2, and 1% respectively. From country to country, these causes may have different contribution, but ratio of causes approximately the same. The contribution of different causes to acute occupational poisoning is following. The most part is disadvantages of instrument of labor. Other factors contributed in acute occupational diseases in decreasing order are contact with infectious agents, deviation from technological regulations, and safety violations. Acute poisoning means short-term exposure to hazard chemical, short-term latent period, and chemical concentration in the working zone is much more than maximum allowable concentration. The first place is in the structure of occupational pathology belongs to diseases caused by physical factors. Among the main nosological forms in this group, the neurosensory hearing loss, vibration disease, is monopoly neuropathies prevail. The second ranking place belongs to diseases due to overload and overstrain of individual organs and systems. This group includes, first of all, such diseases as radiculopathy of different localization, mono and polyneuropathy, periarthrosis, and deforming osteoarthrosis. The third place is for occupational diseases from the effects of industrial aerosols. This group is represented by such pathologies as pneumoconiosis, chronic dust bronchitis, and chronic obstructive bronchitis. Fourth place is taken with intoxication caused by harmful chemical factors of production. For example, fluorosis, chronic obstructive bronchitis, and chronic toxic dust bronchitis. The share of occupational pathology from impact of other harmful production factors is less than 4%. There are diseases caused by biological factors, allergies, and occupational cancer. Among all the factors of occupational intoxications are, first of all, carbon monoxide, manganese, mercury, lead, and hydrogen sulfide. Causes of group poisonings are aliphatic saturated hydrocarbons, dihydrosulfate, and carbon oxide. Causes of fatalities are hydrogen sulfide and carbon oxide. We move on to the third part of our lecture that will be about labor protection system. The aims of labor protection system are to ensure a working environment that provides workers with complete safety against physical and mental hazards, and with a standard of technical protection, occupational hygiene, and welfare, responding at all times to the technological and social progress of society. To ensure safe working conditions and a meaningful employment situation for the individual worker. To provide a basis on which employer can themselves solve the working environment problems in cooperation with the occupational organizations and subject to supervision and guidance from the public authorities. It costs much less to anticipate and eliminate the hazard in the planning stage than it does to manage it afterward. In cases where there is an existing hazard, the industrial hygienist must work with the engineer to develop control methods to reduce or eliminate the hazard. The system of labor production includes some major groups. Firstly, legislative measures, then administrative methods of management, technological development, sanitary measures and treatment and prophylactic measures. Let's consider each of them one by one. So the first group includes constitutional rights, labor legislation, and sanitation. A very important measure is the substantiation of safe time-weighted concentrations for occupational poisons and safe levels for physical factors. Time-weighted average concentration or level is a concentration for a conventional 8-hour workday and 40-hour work week, to which is believed that nearly all workers may be repeatedly exposed day after day without adverse effects. There are some organizations that establish standards for protection of workers from occupational exposure. The first of all is Occupational Safety and Health Administration, OSHA. It establishes permissible exposure levels. Then, National Institute for Occupational Safety and Health, NIOSH, establishes recommended exposure limits. And the American Conference of Governmental Industrial Hygienists establishes threshold limit values. Threshold limit value is an estimate based on the known toxicity in humans or animals of a given chemical substance and the reliability and accuracy of the latest sampling and analytical methods. It's not a static definition, since new research can often modify the risk assessment of substances. And new laboratory or instrumental analysis methods can improve analytical detection limits. Note that the threshold limit values are not mandatory federal or state employee exposure standards, in contrast to permissible exposure levels established by OSHA. Also, it's important to monitor the concentration of the occupational chemical substances in the air of the working zone to compare it with maximum permissible concentration. On this slide, you can see how the industrial hygienist assesses chemical concentration in the breathing zone, the manner of use, and the duration of exposure. The same concerns to monitor of physical factors, for example, noise. Secondly, administrative methods of management. Engineering controls are to be used at the first line of defense against workplace hazards. Some circumstances require administrative control, such as in cases when engineering controls are not technologically visible or during the installation of engineering controls. So, administrative measures include scientific management of labor, safety of measures, and layout of the workplace. Administrative control of occupational hazards, such as work period reduction, job rotation, appropriate work practices, and proper maintenance, depends on constant employee implementation on intervention, which makes them a less desirable form of control. However, administrative controls are often useful in supplementing engineering controls to achieve acceptable exposure levels. The majority of the major occupational health standards require administrative control measures, including hygienic change rooms regulated areas and specific work and hygiene practices. Technological measures include, first of all, the substitution of non-toxic or less toxic materials for highly toxic ones. However, an industrial hygienist must exercise extreme caution when substituting one chemical for another to ensure that some previously unforeseen hazard does not occur along with the substitution. Examples of such include fire hazards, synergistic interactions between chemical exposure, or previously unknown toxicity problems attributed to the non-toxic substitute chemicals. The classic examples of substitution is replacement of violet in paint pigments by zinc, barium, or titanium oxides. The use of phosphorus succinic white sulfide instead of white phosphorus in matchmaking. Shot blasting instead of sound blasting, and substitution of calcium silicates and mineral wool for asbestos as an insulating material. Recently, new vismus-containing alloys has replaced lead in the marking of brass and bronze alloys. This substitution not only minimizes health concerns due to employee exposures to lead, it reduces the overall cost of hygienic standard compliance. As technology advances and more toxicity information become available, the substitution of degreasing solvents progressed from carbon tetrachloride to chlorinated hydrocarbons, such as trichloroethylene and trichloroethylene. When studies revealed the possible carcinogenicity of chlorinated solvents, these solvents were replaced with fluorinated hydrocarbons. Because the fluorinated hydrocarbon solvents have been identified as ozone depleters, hydrochlorofluorocarbons are likely interim candidates for industrial degreasing. A change in the physical condition of raw material is another technological measure. For example, pelletized or briquette forms of materials are less dusty and can drastically reduce atmospheric gas contamination in some processes. The next technological measure is changing the process. It includes workflow automation and continuous process. A changing process offers a vital chance to improve working conditions. Most changes are made to improve quality or reduce the cost of production. In some cases, a process can be modified to reduce the dispersion of dust or fume, and thus markedly reduce the hazard. For example, in the automotive industry, the amount of lead dust created by grinding solder seams with small high-speed rotary sound disks was greatly reduced by changing to low-speed oscillating type sanders. More recently, lead solder was replaced with thin solder and silicone materials. Brush painting or dipping instead of spray painting can minimize the concentration of airborne contaminants. Other examples of process changes is using vapor degreasing in tanks with adequate ventilation controls to replace hand washing of parts in open containers, and so on. Another technological measure is isolation. Potentially hazardous operations should be isolated to minimize exposure to employees. The isolation can be a physical barrier, such as acoustic panels used to minimize noise transmission. The isolation can be in terms of time, such as providing remote control, semi-automatic equipment, so that an operator does not have to stay near the noisy machine constantly. Or the worker may be isolated or enclosed in a soundproof control booth with a clean source of air supplied to the booth. Exposure to employees may likewise be minimized by isolating hazardous materials in place. For example, exposure to asbestos-containing materials and lead-based paint can be avoided in some instances by sealing these materials in airtight enclosures. When very toxic materials are to be processed, Automation can be used to allow handling of equipment from remote locations. Robotic techniques can reproduce many industrial procedures, thus eliminate workers' exposure. The work area can be viewed by remote control television cameras or mirrors. Segregating a hazardous operation or locating one or more such operations together in a separate enclosure or building not only sharply reduces the number of workers exposed, but greatly simplifies the necessary control procedures. Enclosing the process or equipment is a desirable method of control because the enclosure prevents or minimizes the escape of contaminants into the workroom atmosphere. Enclosed equipment is usually tightly sealed and is opened only during cleaning or filling operations. Examples of such equipment include glove boxes. Some operations require complete enclosure. Here, a technician works with aluminum powder used in atomic reactor fuel elements at a glove box. He is wearing a film badge and air sampler on his lapel. Another technological measure is the using of mechanical handling devices. On this slide, you can see the using of tongs. Also, basket is a mechanical handling device for prevent direct contact human body with chemicals. Manual handling equipment such as pallet trucks, trolleys, and sack trucks can prevent overload or overstrain. The next group of labor protective system is sanitary measures. This group includes adequate illumination and microclimate, reduction in sound level due to capsulation, noise proofing, vibration reduction, and industrial ventilation. Ventilation is a method of controlling the work environment by strategically supplying, adding, or exhausting, removing air from premises. Ventilation is used to dilute the concentration of contaminants to acceptable levels, to remove contaminants at their source, and to heat or cool the work environment. Ventilation can also serve to control humidity, odor, and other environmental conditions for worker comfort. There are two basic types of ventilation systems: natural ventilation or aeration and artificial ventilation. Combination of both is called mixed ventilation. Natural ventilation uses natural convection through open doors, windows, and chimneys. Artificial ventilation can be general or local. Combination of general and local ventilation is called combined. General ventilation may be with the predominance of the influx, predominantly exhaust ventilation, and balanced when influx and outflux air volumes are equal. Local ventilation may be inlet and exhaust. General ventilation systems supply and exhaust large volumes of air from workspaces. They are used for temperature and humidity control or to dilute the concentration of an air contaminant below hazardous levels. This system uses air movement produced by mechanical fans or blowers. Exhaust fans mounted in roofs, walls, or windows constitute general ventilation. The major disadvantage of general or dilution ventilation is that employee exposures can be very difficult to control near the source of contaminant, where sufficient dilution has not yet occurred. General ventilation should not be used where there are major localized sources of air contamination, especially highly toxic dusts and fumes. Local exhaust ventilation is more effective and economical in such cases. A typical system consists of one or more hoods, ducts, and air cleaner if needed, and a fan. Local exhaust ventilation is considered the classic method of control. Local exhaust systems capture or contain contaminants at their source before they escape into the work air environment. Local exhaust systems remove air contaminants rather than just dilute them. But removal of the contaminant is not always 100% effective. This method should be used when the contaminant cannot be controlled by substitution, changing the process, isolation, or enclosure. Also, a process has been isolated, it still may require local exhaust system. A major advantage of local exhaust ventilation systems is that they require less airflow than dilution general ventilation systems. The total airflow is important for plants that are heated to cool it, because heating and air conditioning costs are a significant operating expense. Also, local exhaust systems can be used to conserve or reclaim reusable materials. This slide demonstrates a typical local exhaust ventilation system. You can see that dust collector traps are near a contaminant source, so the worker is not exposed to harmful concentration of the chemical. This slide shows how the fumes arising from lead melting operations are controlled by local lateral slot exhaust ventilation. Another type of industrial ventilation is aeration. It's a natural ventilation when air movement within a work area due to wind and temperature differences between the exterior and interior of a building. It's used in the hot workshops only, for instance, with open hearth furnace. Lastly, group of labor protective system is treatment and prophylactic measures. It includes medical examinations, outpatients and inpatient treatment, physiotherapy, use of personal protective equipment, hygienic education, and diet therapy. Diet therapy is used for the limitation of accumulation of harmful substances in the human body, the removing harmful substances from the body, the improving the functional status of organs and systems. When facility and process design can eliminate all contact with irritants, personal protective equipment must be used. They are gloves, gauntlets, aprons, face shields, boots made of a material that is impervious to the particular substance and chemicals. These, along with goggles, afford sufficient protection in most cases. Disposable gauntlets, aprons, boots, and gloves are available, but they are more subjected to tears than heavier safety gear. Other gear may provide insulation against heat or light. The use of gloves requires caution. A common mistake is to recommend tabi or neoprene gloves we used as hand protection against a solvent, regardless of the kind of solvent in use. Many solvents can quickly penetrate like a rubber or neoprene gloves and come in contact with skin, with the skin. A barrier cream is the least effective way of protecting skin. Workers at risk for a splash of chemicals in the eyes must wear appropriate protective eyewear. It must be noted that protective eyewear should not be used as the sole protection, but in conjunction with engineering control guards and good manufacturing practice. Respirators are not used as the primarily or only means of protection against hazardous chemical vapors, because too many factors limit their use. They can be used as emergency or backup protection. For protection of ear, different types of ear muffs and ear plugs are used. Personal hygiene is an important control measure. The worker should be able to wash exposed skin promptly to remove accidental splashes of toxic or irritant materials. If workers start to minimize contact with harmful chemical agents, they must have easier access to hand washing facilities. Inconveniently located wash basin invade such undesirable practices as washing at workstations with solvents, mineral oils, or industrial detergents, none of which is appropriate or intended for skin cleaning. Powdered soaps provide a feeling of removing soils because of stimulation of the nerve endings in the skin by the abrasives. Soaps may also contribute to industrial dermatitis. Sensitive persons may require pH-neutral soaps or moisturizing agents. Antibacterial soaps are necessary in workplaces where infectious agents may be present. The common practice of removing particulates from clothing or disposable coveralls using compressed air should be forbidden. This practice causes the material to become airborne and increases the risk of employee exposure. These devices are used only in the hot workshop. The eating, storage, or drinking of food and beverages in the areas where toxic materials are used should be forbidden too. In the last part of our lecture, we consider medical examination of workers more detail. They are an important part of the labor protection system and are included in the group of treatment and prophylactic measures. There are two types of medical examinations, pre-employment and in-employment. Pre-employment medical examinations are an important part of ensuring a safe and healthy workforce, as hiring those physically unable to do the job tasks, places, and added burden and risk of injury on co-workers. Replacement evaluation can range from a simple drug screen, a medical history review by a registered nurse, to a complete medical and occupational history and physical examination, with functional capacity testing and other tests. There are some occupations for which a zero evaluation is appropriate. There are some goals of preliminary examinations. We want to find out whether the worker is suffering from any diseases that is dangerous for his fellow workers, whether the job for which the worker is applying or which is being offered to him entails any risks for his health, and whether there are any particular jobs to which he or she should not be assigned or posts for which he is better suited. Required information about person for pre-employment medical examination is presented on this slide. It includes present state of health, any past diseases in his family, any past diseases he has suffered himself, his average alcohol intake, how much he smokes, jobs he had since leaving school, conditions and duration of them, also occupational accidents and diseases that he may have incurred. The information about person can be obtained from any official records or from the factory's files. The subject is questioned about it, but the subject himself will not readily make any declaration liable to compromise his engagement and will almost always play down any weak points or even conceal them completely. The examination should be carried out methodically. It will be quick and efficient if the occupational, psychological, sensorial, physiological, and psychoaffective characteristics makes a point of discussing, examining, and taking duly account his medical and occupational history supplied during the preceding interview. Information of this kind may reveal counterindications for certain occupations. Counterindications for professions is a list of diseases in the presence of which a person will not be able to study and then work in the chosen specialty, because his presence or may present harm for his health. For example, if worker has asthma, the work is in dust-laden atmosphere may be dangerous for him. The same situation in case of epileptic and the work at the scaffolding. The goals of in-employment medical examinations, other words, periodic checkups, are periodic observation of workers' health state, early detection of health disorders, detection some disorder hitherto unnoticed, find out whether there is any connection between the upset of the worker's health and his job, risk group identification and health rehabilitation, and of course, improving prevention in the enterprises. Otherwise, the indicated health disorder will progress and more worker will suffer. The next goal is the identification of common diseases that are counterindications for continuation of work. And the last one, determination whether the worker is still fit to do his job. Periods for these checkups are determined by nature of production factors that influence workers on the certain enterprises. But periodic health examinations must be performed at least once per 2 years. For persons under 21 years old, once per year. The risk management includes cause-effect relation, analysis evaluation of workers' health, depending on working conditions, risk informing, and professional risk monitoring. Indeed, labor protection is a complex and difficult task, so many scientists and appliance researchers are contribute to the subject area. They are occupational hygiene, physiology and psychology of work, occupational toxicology, occupational diseases, scientific management of labor, technical aesthetic, and psychohygiene, and so on. Specialists who deal with occupational disease and occupational health are occupational physician and nurse, psychologist, psychotherapist, epidemiologist, toxicologist, microbiologist, chemist, technician, statistician. Engineering professionals are involved with the design and modification of manufacturing processes and facilities supporting these processes. Because these processes may introduce health and safety hazards into the workplace, engineers must coordinate the plants with the safety professionals and the industrial hygienists. Our lecture is over. Thank you for attention. Goodbye.